Ladies and gentlemen, let's get started. This is the program on constitutional government, and our speaker today is Jonathan Haidt. Jonathan Haidt is a Thomas Cooley Professor of Ethical Leadership at the New York University Stern School of Business. He went to Yale, graduated in 1985, and got a PhD from Penn, Pennsylvania, and then taught, I guess, most of his career up to now at the University of Virginia, mm-hmm. But is now at NYU. He says, I think this is self-description, that he's a social psychologist who studies the culture wars. Mm-hmm. The culture wars in plural.
Yes, there are many.
Yeah, that was it. But he's going to talk today on two values of universities which are opposed or in conflict, incompatible. I should say, too, that he's the author of The Happiness Hypothesis and of perhaps his most famous book, The Righteous Mind, Why Good People Are Divided by Politics and Religion. He verges on the edge of moral philosophy and of political science to politics and religion, you heard. And he's written an article in The Atlantic, which got a lot of attention, on the coddling of the American mind. So, Jonathan Haidt.
Thank you, Harvey. Thank you, everyone. I published an article last August called The Coddling of the American Mind with Greg Lukianoff. And then a couple months later, it seemed as though many American universities kind of melted down into beautiful illustrations of exactly what we were talking about in the article, is the way it seemed. Very strange things are happening on American college campuses. I believe that there is a new moral order that has been germinating in a few university departments for more than a decade that kind of burst forth and spread very widely last fall. It is pushing up against a very different view of what university ethics, university culture should be, and that's what I want to talk with you today about. So there's one of my favorite quotes for thinking about intellectual life is this from John Stuart Mill. He who knows only his own side of a case knows little of that. His reasons may be good and no one may have been able to refute them, but if he is equally unable to refute the reasons on the opposite side, if he does not so much as know what they are, he has no ground for preferring either opinion. Mill was so wise about our biases, our flaws, our overconfidence, our pig-headedness. Mill understood that you need freedom of speech because we have to be challenged. If we're not challenged, we believe things with no good justification. Mill is, I think, the most eloquent spokesman in the Western tradition for the importance of free speech, which I think we are gradually losing in universities because this vision of university life is receding in the face of a very different view. At least this is my argument to you today. The alternative view comes from Karl Marx. So here are some words that were written the decade before Mill wrote his words. So I've heard this phrase around, the point is not to understand the world, but to change it. And when I looked it up, it turns out what Marx actually wrote is pretty much that. But here's the exact words from the thesis on Feuerbach. This is a very, very different way of thinking about what our goal is at a university. What are students trying to do? What are we trying to help them do? What are we preparing them to do? When I showed up at Yale in 1981, this is what it says above the gate at Phelps Hall, Lux et Veritas. It literally has the word truth written in stone, and you walk under those words. Gradually, though, in the 90s, and especially in the last 10 or 15 years, I believe the etching on stone is changing. If you look closely, if you go down to New Haven, you look closely, it actually now says change. Okay, not literally, but that's what it is beginning to feel like. The point of an education is change, is to help students change things. And not just any change, but social justice. Social justice has become, of course it was there, you know, when I was at Yale in the 80s, we all were very concerned about Nicaragua and El Salvador and South Africa and fighting for social justice in those countries. But it's become much more explicit, and I think it's come much more into the classroom, the quest for social justice. After thinking about this for the whole year, And it's been, while it's been kind of horrifying in a way as a professor to watch these changes. It's been incredibly interesting as someone who studies moral psychology to see this conflict of moral visions. But my belief now is that we must ultimately have a schism. The only way that we can actually proceed, we're kind of stuck with this conflict now, is to have a schism. We need some schools devoted to social justice. We need some schools devoted to truth. So again, that's the story that I'm going to tell you today. I'll try to back up that claim so that by the end of my talk, I might have persuaded you of that. And if I haven't, please push back, because if I don't know your arguments, I can't know my own. So I'll just briefly go through eight points today. I think it's very helpful to start, whenever we reflect on what are we doing at university, the Aristotelian notion of telos is extremely helpful. So Aristotle, Greek philosophers of that era, would analyze things in terms of multiple causes, and what is the end purpose or goal of an object, person, or practice? Then we can evaluate, how well does this instantiation meet that goal? Is this a good knife? Well, if it's dull, if it doesn't cut, it's not a good knife. And we can ask that about various professions. The telos of medicine obviously is health or healing, scholarship is truth, and law is justice. Here are two other professions, business and social justice. These are not closed guilds in the same way as the three on top, but nonetheless, we might say that the telos of business is profit, or more positively, the creation of value from which others benefit and the business person, him or herself, benefits as well. And I think we can speak of social justice as a profession. There are many young people today who are training for a career in social justice. What is their telos? And I believe it is racial equality. And I mean that as a stand-in for all other kinds of equality, for gender equality, LGBT rights, but a focus on addressing inequalities and removing disparities. So each profession has a telos. That's great. That's wonderful. That's necessary, because each field interacts with the others in constructive ways. So business helps us all achieve our telos. Nobody could do anything, practically, if there weren't businesses helping them. These are three of my favorite companies, because I am a much better scholar than I would have been had I been born 30 or 40 years earlier and I didn't have access to these products. I can find a lot more truth because of their help. And then, of course, these professions return the favor. Businesses draw on doctors, lawyers, and scholars to help them innovate and make products. Similarly, we can say for social justice, it helps all of us achieve our telos. If doctors are treating patients differently based on race, if scholars are studying the lives of men but not women, well, then the doctors are failing to bring health as much as they could, and the scholars are failing to find truth as much as they could. So social justice activists can hold our feet to the fire. They have specialized knowledge and ability to detect discrimination where other people hadn't noticed it. So this is a very constructive form of interaction. And of course, other fields return the favor and make social justice activists more effective. So this is all well and good. But there's another kind of interaction, which is in which fields rub up against each other and one field injects its telos into the other. So when I teach at the Stern School of Business, I teach a business ethics class, and a lot of the cases that we use are about cases where business interests business rubs up against medicine, let's say, and doctors start thinking of their patients as profit centers. How can I get the maximum billing out of this patient? When they do that, they betray their telos. Scholars, economists, many others who took all kinds of money from the banks to write papers justifying credit default swaps, whether or not they believed what they were saying, they probably were influenced. Conflicts of interest are very, very difficult to overcome. So scholars often betray their telos when business and the academy rub up against each other, et cetera. And I think the same thing happens with social justice. Again, social justice in general is a good thing, but when it injects its telos into other fields, it makes people betray their telos and they become less able to do their job. I think this has happened in scholarship. A lot of scholarship aims to promote social justice, and therefore it betrays the truth. Again, I will justify that in a moment. The key piece of psychology you need to know for this argument is motivated reasoning. You've all heard the phrase or similar phrases. The bottom line is that we're very bad at saying which side has more truth. Let me weigh them. We don't do that. What we do is we say, if I want to believe proposition X, I ask myself, can I believe it? Do I have permission to believe it? And then I scan everything I know. I might consult people. I might Google it. If I have any reason to believe it, I'm done. I stop thinking because I can justify my belief. So I stop. And similarly, if I don't want to believe it, I look for an escape hatch. We're all very good at this. We're all able to believe pretty much whatever we want to believe. Not anything. We're not crazy, but there's ambiguity in the real world. So just as, as one example, in one study, students come into the lab. They are evaluating, they're told to evaluate a scientific paper. The paper looks like it's from the journal Science, and it reports a finding that that caffeine consumption is correlated with breast cancer, in breast cancer rates. And their job is to evaluate the methods. How good is the study? And so who do you think finds flaws in the study? Who would find, who would be motivated to disbelieve that?
Coffee drinkers.
You know, so all coffee drinkers want to disbelieve that, right? Women who drink coffee don't want to believe that coffee is bad for them. So they find many, many flaws in the study, whereas the other people have no vested interest to say, oh, okay, I guess, well, I didn't know that. So we're not, again, we're not crazy, but when there's ambiguity, we see what we want to see. And in any moral or political debate of our era, or of any era, there's ambiguity, so people on both sides believe, they're able to support their beliefs. That's called motivated reasoning. Now, this is obviously something that happens in scholarship, not in your scholarship, but in the scholarship of others in your field. So when scholarship is undertaken to support a political agenda, when the scholar has a political agenda, they're not going to go into the complicated historical record or into a large, complicated database and say, which way does the data go? They don't say that. What they say is, you know, I believe Proposition X. I believe women were treated in this way. I believe poverty is caused by that. And you go and you say, you know, can I believe it? And you look and, wow, yes, here I have support. So we're almost always successful. We almost never believe that we're biased. And if we publish something that the field likes, it will spread like wildfire and you will never call it back. 20 years from now, even if it's debunked the following year, 20 years from now, it will still be cited because people want to believe it. Now there is one protection. We have one major protection against this problem, which is institutionalized disconfirmation. That's the origin of science. That's what makes science such a brilliant institution. It was a community of individual gentlemen scholars, I suppose, in Europe began once there was the printing press, coffee houses, ways for people to share ideas. If you have a community of people who kind of know each other and are responsible to each other and critique each other, then you get institutionalized disconfirmation. I am terrible at disconfirming my ideas because I think all of my ideas are true. But you don't, others don't. And truth is a process. Truth isn't a thing that you that you can point to. Truth in the sciences is a process. And if you have the system set up right, truth does emerge from flawed, biased, motivated reasoners. So that's all great, right? But what happens when there's no more institutionalized disconfirmation? This graph shows the ratio of faculty on the left and the right in this country. This is representative data from the Higher Education Research Institute. And so as late as the 1990s, the left-right ratio of university professors was 2-1, just 2-1 left-right, which is fine. There's no problem with that. You have institutionalized disconfirmation. But by 2011, it was up to 5-1. And it's much, much worse than it looks because all of these numbers include the dental school, the agriculture school, the engineering school. And there are conservatives there. But if you look at the core areas of the humanities and social science, economics is the only one that has conservatives. New data out, economics is only 5-1 left to right. 5-1, there are five, and that was based on voter registration, 5 Democrats for every 1 Republican in economics. And that's okay. I mean, that's really far left, but there at least, there's probably gonna be a Republican in the room somewhere. But in the other social sciences, it's not like that. So this is my field. This is social psychology. And my colleagues and I collected all the evidence we could find on the political views of professors of psychology. And what we found, as you can see, in 1960, one study asked who you voted for. And so 4-1, they voted for Kennedy. And it asked them to recall who they'd voted for previously. And so as you see, about 2-1, roughly, Democrat over Republican. Again, that's fine. The Academy leans left, but there are Republicans around. The circles indicate not Democrat-Republican, but liberal-conservative. A study in 1996 found just 4-1 left-right for psychology professors. But several studies since then have found that just since the 90s, as in the graph I showed you before, the academy really changed beginning in the late 90s as the greatest generation retired, replaced by the baby boomers. The academy goes from leaning left to being entirely on the left in many departments. And just last week, a new study came out by Langbert and others. They looked at voter registration data in 5 departments, and here's the newest number on psychology. 17-1. So it's going up and up and up. You can now pretty much count on the fact in any psychology function that everybody voted for the Democrat. Everybody is in favor of all the things you're in favor of. There is no more political diversity in psychology. I'm like the only one, and I'm not a conservative. I'm like, you know, so if I'm around, people have to be careful what they say because I'm a nothing. I'm a centrist. But other than me, like, there's nobody. No, there's one guy. There's one other guy. So this has, I think, profound implications for universities. For students, I think what this means is that students who have arrived on universities in the last 5 years or so are encountering an environment more politically orthodox than any that has existed since perhaps the 18th century when schools were divinity schools. Now, I don't know the 19th century history, but certainly the 20th century, I don't think you could find a university or that the climate was as uniformly on one side or the other as we have now. People don't understand just how fast the change has been in the last 15 or 20 years. Most people don't know this. And what this means is that students hold their beliefs very, very strongly, but they don't know how to support them. And you find this if you get into a discussion or debate with students about social justice or other concepts, they often cannot explain what they mean because they have not been challenged. They have not gone through the million process. Another implication of this is that students are walking on eggshells. As orthodoxy becomes more and more powerful, people are afraid of crossing the orthodoxy. And I hear this as I speak at schools all over the country. Students are actually kind of bored in seminar classes because someone will say something and nobody dares push back or argue. People are self-censoring much more than they did before. There are a lot of reasons for that. Social media is a big one. But students are walking on eggshells much more than they did in the past. And some, I believe, my assertion, I can't prove this, but I believe that the lack of challenge makes students intellectually fragile. That is, since they're not accustomed to hearing ideas that contradict their most cherished ideas, if someone were to come to campus, let's suppose some university were to invite a conservative, like an actual conservative, to campus who was going to give a talk, you might think, well, just don't go. If you don't want to hear them, just don't go. But that's not good enough, because those disgusting, horrible ideas will be on my campus, and I can't have that. So I'm going to protest. We're going to get together. We're going to protest. We're going to have bullhorns. We're going to shout them down. We can't allow these hateful, violent ideas to be expressed on our campus. This is intellectual fragility. These are the kind of students that we are turning out. Again, I'm exaggerating. The science students are fine. This is not touching the sciences. And it's not that most students are like this, but increasing numbers are. And those students who are dedicated to this new moral view have an outsized influence on the culture, and others, which are often the majority, are afraid to cross them. That's what I'm hearing. It has enormous implications for faculty. Political orthodoxy means that certain subjects are really, really sexy or hot or wonderful. We all charge into those. I heard there was an article in the New York Times recently. There are very few courses on political and military history are declining. Nobody gets a PhD in those topics, so we're running out of people to teach those. So now there are lots of topics that are important besides those, but does that mean that those topics should not be taught? Political and military history in a history department? We might not have that anymore in 10 or 20 years, et cetera. Also, students, faculty are increasingly afraid of their students as they all hear stories from other professors who were teaching what they thought was a perfectly innocent way, and suddenly they're being reported to the dean for marginalization or insensitivity, and they say, you know, what? Wait, but so students, faculty are increasingly changing what they teach, removing anything that could be controversial that could arouse offense. So again, students don't know just how homogeneous and safe the climate is that they are encountering. Things are really changing over the last 5 years, I believe. So that's motivated reasoning. The reason why the uniformity leads to orthodoxy is because of the psychology of sacredness. This is, I think, one of our big evolutionary innovations. there are examples of species that can build large things like bees and termites. They can build gigantic, gigantic structures. But that's because they're all siblings. They're sisters or sisters and brothers. So evolution found this trick of if you have one queen, all the children, they can all work together. So only one species that can build large things without being siblings, and that's humans. So in every every civilization, the archaeological record begins with temples. Humans have this ability to make something sacred and then circle around it. So these are Muslims at prayer in Mecca in the Kaaba. So it could be a river like the Ganges, it could be a rock, a tree, an ancestor, a mountain. Something is sacred. And if we worship it, if we circle around it, that binds us together, we trust each other. So I'm very much a devotee of Emil Durkheim and his views about religion and sacredness. So we make something sacred, we circle around it. And Durkheim himself used the metaphor that ritual creates social electricity. If you move a wire through a magnetic field, you generate charged particles, you generate the capacity to do work. So Durkheim himself used that metaphor. It doesn't have to be a religious object. It can be a flag. It can be anything that you make sacred. You can then trust each other, and you'll fight and die alongside each other and risk your life for your co-worshippers. So what's sacred at university? This is Raphael's School of Athens. You see people are arguing, disputing, discussing, showing, just gesturing. What are they doing? What are they circling around? I think the answer is pretty clear. It's right here on your motto, right here on your logo. Veritas. This at least is the story we've told ourselves for, 300 years now. Our universities are organized around truth, around the pursuit of truth. But as I said, things are changing. Things are changing fast, not in all departments, but in the humanities and in many of the various studies departments. I think what is now sacred is victims. Victims become sacred, and sacred means no trade-offs, no criticisms. There are six sacred groups, I believe. If you just read the campus newspaper, you read the New York Times, where do the big blow-ups erupt on campus in the United States? And it's mostly around race issues, gender issues, and LGBT. So those are the big three sacred groups. There are three others that are, of course, important, but they don't seem to be involved in as many conflicts on campus. And we're living through, as I said, an extraordinary moral revolution. I've never seen morality change as fast as it has in the last 2 years. I think you'd have to go back to 1968, from what I understand, to see a similarly quick change. Muslims have recently been added on some campuses as being a sacred group that if you criticize them, then you're Islamophobic. Transgender issues, obviously, and Black Lives Matter. So for very good reasons, I'm not criticizing any of these groups. There are issues of exclusion. There are real racial issues. There are all sorts of issues we need to work on. But I believe that when a university treats certain groups as sacred, it loses the ability to have intelligent discussions that could actually lead to insights that could actually address problems. The hallmark, as I said, of sacred thinking is no trade-offs, no jokes, no insults, no utilitarian trade-offs. So, if an artist creates an art installation using the American flag or the Bible, people on the left will say, that's fine, that's subversive, it's just a piece of paper, it's just a piece of cloth, and the right will get all angry about it. There's all kinds of sacredness on the left, any hero. So sacredness works on both sides. If you have intense passion, if you have a community organized around the pursuit of some goal, you probably have sacred people, objects, or ideas, and you will be furious at a very slight violation of their dignity. When we circle around in this way, if we want to go with the electrical metaphor, the electromagnetic metaphor, you create a polarity. Our side becomes perfectly good, and their side becomes perfectly evil. That's what polarization is. That's what charged particles do. And so I think we can see this, what's really happening. The best explanation for what's happening on campus, I believe, comes from two sociologists, Brad Campbell and Jason Manning. They wrote a paper two or three years ago in an obscure sociology journal. And I found it during last fall. And I thought, my God, this is like the Rosetta Stone. This explains everything that's happening. And so I summarized it. If you go to heterodoxacademy.org, you can look for victimhood culture. You'll find a condensation of this article made available to the public. Very, very briefly, their story is that many societies used to have honor cultures where a gentleman cannot tolerate a stain upon his honor. Female honor is different, but also cannot tolerate a stain. So even tiny little things can lead to a duel. Tiny little violations are a problem. So that's the way many societies are. But as the economy builds up, as commerce becomes more important, as you get more diversity, more sheer numbers, it's very hard to have a dueling culture. People have more an attitude of live and let live, I'll trade with you, I'll exchange with you, I don't care what you believe in your private life. We'll have misunderstandings, I'm just gonna look the other way. So in a dignity culture, it's commendable to have thick skin. People might say, as I heard when I was growing up, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Now we all understand words can still hurt, but you have to learn to ignore that kind of hurt, because ultimately it's up to how you interpret it. That's at least what the ancients have told us, East and West, for thousands of years, that your interpretation is crucial for whether or not you suffer. But what the sociologists say is that in the last few years, we've begun to transition on some college campuses to a victimhood culture, which has the feature of an honor culture that any slight violation is now a serious problem, must be addressed, but here's the key, you don't address it yourself. In an honor culture, a man would never seek out someone's help to solve the problem. If he does that, he loses his dignity. But in a victimhood culture, there are only two ways to gain prestige. That is to emphasize your victimhood, to show all the cuts and bruises you've had from all the things that have happened to you. The more you have, the more prestige you have. But if you're in the unfortunate situation of not having been victimized, all you can do to gain status is to really vociferously prosecute other people who victimize other people. And so you have a culture of grievance, you have constant argument and anger, and the aggrieved emphasize their oppression and social marginalization. Now, I think this is extremely bad for the students themselves. The very idea that we have on campus departments and courses and ideas that are teaching our students to judge people by their race and sex, to say there's a good sex and a bad sex, there's a good gender and a bad gender. The very idea that we're teaching our students to evaluate people's ideas based on their social position, I think is contrary to the spirit of the university, but I think it's really, really bad for the students because it teaches them the exact cognitive distortions that cognitive therapy is designed to correct. Black and white thinking, making a mountain out of a molehill. So this is why you end up with eternal conflict and grievance, you end up with students walking on eggshells and self-censoring, and you end up with them demanding what you might call a safety culture. Safety culture is a set of ideas that say, of course, violence is way, way, way down. The world is incredibly safe. Our cities are unbelievably safe. Our campuses are even safer. So physical violence, while not gone, physical violence is at historically very, very low levels. But you get concept creep. So violence used to involve something about the body or physical. Now violence is words that are hurtful, but only some words that are hurtful. So once you have the idea that words are violence, well, of course, we're all against violence. So we need safe spaces where these words won't come in. We need trigger warnings, etc. And this, the sociologists say, creates what they call moral dependency. The world is so dangerous, but I can't protect myself. I need not you and you and you. I need administrators. I need adults to protect me. There have to be things to protect me, and adults have to do that. So a nice example of this was just before the first presidential debate at Hofstra University. Now, you'd think that Hofstra University was really pleased and proud to host this major event, but what do they do? No, they put a trigger warning outside. So Hofstra students who attended to the debate were told that there could be triggering things. Donald Trump is here. This could trigger you, but don't worry. There are five agencies. We have five agencies that can help you through this, that can help you through this. What does that do to students? Does that strengthen them? Or does that make them hypersensitive to the fact that, well, I am kind of upset. Oh my goodness, I can't believe what he just said. If we believe that expectancy effects, if we believe that thinking someone is stupid will eventually make them sometimes perform, if you have any belief that expectancy effects can actually shape people, this is really bad stuff. And the reason, the basic psychology here, is because people are anti-fragile. What doesn't kill me makes me stronger. Now, there are exceptions to that. There is such a thing as PTSD. I'm not saying this is always true. But as a general principle, there are many things that are anti-fragile in our world. This is from a book by Nassim Taleb. Bone is anti-fragile. If you don't use it, it gets weak. Your immune system is anti-fragile. If you protect your kids from bacteria, you weaken the immune system, and kids are anti-fragile. If you could wrap your kids in protections that they never are insulted, they never hear a racist or sexist comment, they are never excluded, well, that would be a nice thing to do, wouldn't it? Wouldn't you like your kids to be able to go through their whole childhood never experiencing those terrible things? And a moment's reflection tells you that if you were to bubble wrap your child, that when you take the bubble wrap off and send him to college, or her to college, all kinds of things are going to happen. So we have to keep the bubble wrap going. And eventually, we have to take it off. But by then, it's not our responsibility anymore, at least at the university. So again, when Clinton and Trump meet for a debate, what happens? The adults come sweeping in saying, students, now this is going to be hard for you, but don't worry, we're here to help. This, I believe, is debilitating. I believe that we are really causing very direct harm to an entire generation of students. And by we, I mean it's their initiative and, there's plenty of blame to go around, but what we're doing is we're creating a debilitating culture of safety. Because those who embrace this marginalized identity, those who are told, you've been marginalized, your group has been marginalized, if you embrace that, it's part of your identity. I'm not saying that there aren't indignities, I'm not saying there are not problems, but if you are increasingly helped to embrace that as part of your identity, that your group is victimized, this will make you more fragile and more morally dependent. And what are you going to do when you leave college? The only group that benefits from this, I believe, are straight white men. Because if you're a straight white man in college, for 4 years you're told, you're the bad guys. You guys are evil. We have to keep our eye on you. So you're criticized and there's no special administrator to support you. Well, what does that sound like? Constant criticism with no special support? Sounds kind of like a job to me. You're ready for the workplace. So safety culture probably strengthens straight white men. I don't know for sure, but I would guess that they come out stronger. But I'm pretty confident that everybody else, or everybody who embraces safety culture, comes out weaker. So safety culture, while it's designed to foster equality, I believe backfires and creates a world in which straight white men are much better set up for success than those who are not. Next point, blasphemy. If you are with me on this mindset that sacredness and quasi-religious beliefs are permeating the academic space, then we can see the operation of blasphemy laws. So I taught for 16 years at the University of Virginia, a very inspiring place. And all over campus, you have the words of Jefferson emblazoned in stone. One of the most thrilling quotes, certainly it's at the masthead of the newspaper, is that this institution will be based on the illimitable freedom of the human mind, for here we are not afraid to follow truth wherever it may lead, nor to tolerate any error so long as reason is left free to combat it. And so he's basically saying, like John Stuart Mill, if you have institutionalized disconfirmation, that's how we get at the truth. But at a social justice university, religious dogma is protected by blasphemy laws. So here are a few of them. These are just the most obvious ones, where if you deny these statements, you are going to really offend some people. And depending on your department, some people are really going to come back at you and criticize you for denying those. So if you look at how social scientists now deal with questions and problems, it's actually kind of funny. So just to work out one example, women are still underrepresented in STEM and the faculty at STEM departments. What should we do? And obviously here at Harvard, this is where the conversation took place. When Lawrence Summers was invited to a closed-door meeting of people to address this question, of why are there so few women on the STEM faculties. And he said, raise your hand if you actually read his speech. In this room, have you actually read the words that he wrote? Okay, almost nobody has read it. It is brilliant. He doesn't say, oh, because men are smarter than women. He says, it's a complicated thing. There's many factors of causality. There are at least three causes, one of which is discrimination. But one of the three could be that there's a difference in the standard deviation. And we know that there's a difference in the standard deviation. So the argument is at four standard deviations above or below, men are going to outnumber women. So this is what economists do. They think about curves. I mean, how could you bring an economist into this debate and ask him not to think about distributions? So he does that. What do you think about that? Is that a terrible thing to do? I mean, he's like plainly right. There's a lot of evidence that the standard deviation for males is higher than females. Now, some people say, well, maybe not in all countries, or maybe it's shrinking. Fine, but in America, it's been this way for a long time. So is that relevant? Well, it turns out, no, it's not relevant. It's blasphemy. You cannot say that. And what Summers did in that one simple, elegant, carefully worded, nuanced statement, he violated three of the sacred dogma, of the sacred laws of the university, because you cannot question that sexism is endemic on campus and explains disparities. You cannot suggest that victims had anything to do with their victimization, and you cannot suggest that there are any differences of ability or interest between any groups. So that was blasphemy. The bottom line, what I see happening increasingly, I was on the left my whole life until about 4 or 5 years ago. Finally, after writing The Righteous Mind, I said, well, I'm done with this. I'm not in politics. I'm studying this. And once I stepped out, and it's like, I love being a social scientist. We deal with these really complicated problems, and we all know that it's almost never one thing. It's usually multi-causal, multifactorial. But what we do now is we say, you need lots of tools to solve it, but oh, one third of the tools off the table. If you touch them, we shoot you. So that's my point about blasphemy. Now, one of the most important ideas that we have, it's so basic that I can't believe I'm even repeating this, but one of the things that we know is that correlation does not imply causation, right? Raise your hand if you're a social scientist in any way, shape, or form here. Okay, so about a quarter of the room. I mean, this is, you know, like 2 + 2 = 4. So what I do now in my talks is I show this graph. This is recent data showing the distribution of men and women in Silicon Valley. And what you can see in the green bars is that at most of the Silicon Valley firms, women are about 50% of the workforce in the non-tech subdivisions of the company. But if you look at the blue bars, which are the tech, you know, the coders, the programmers, the engineers, women are only about 15 to 20%. So I show this and I ask students, do you see evidence here of systemic sexism? And most of them raise their hand. This is practically the definition of systemic sexism. There's a disparity, it's a big disparity. All right, is that valid? Does that really work? Then I show this graph. This is the distribution of PhDs in 2015. And so in engineering, men got about 75% of the PhDs, and women only 25%. Math, physics, business, men get most of the PhDs. And then I ask the students, do you see evidence here of systemic sexism? And most of them raise their hand. This is the definition of systemic sexism. There's a big disparity. And then I show them the rest of the graph. Women get most of the PhDs in this country. Women get most of the master's degrees, most of the BAs. Women are doing really, really well in education. More power to them, God bless them. Is this sexism, that men and women make different choices of what PhD to get? Even within the sciences, women gravitate to health sciences, social sciences, biology. They tend not to gravitate to engineering and physical sciences. And then I ask the students, so now look at this. Do you see signs of systemic sexism? And some hands still go up, but it's fewer hands and they're slower to rise because now they're kind of confused and they don't quite know, but it's still, those bars aren't the same. So I think that's systemic sexism. But there are other explanations. The biggest one, which is the one that I think accounts for most of the variance, is that when we are in utero, we all start off as girls, and a little bit of testosterone comes out around the 10th week of gestation, and it changes the body to the male pattern, and along the way it changes the brain. This is why kids' toy preferences are different. No matter what you do, you can't make your boy play with girls' toys or your girl play with boy toys. I mean, you can interest them for a while. But on average, girls like girl toys and boys like boy toys, not because the grown-ups tried to make them do that. It comes out of their brain. Boys and girls play differently. They have different play styles, different conversational styles. As they grow up, one way to describe the difference is that men are more interested or drawn to physical systems, and women are more interested and drawn to social systems and people. This is one of the effects of prenatal testosterone. And of course, if you say that, it's blasphemy, but nonetheless, it's true. And so if we look at data on interest in high school, so American high school students, nationally representative data, so this bar here shows interest in, when you ask high school kids, are you interested in a career in science? This is the line for women from 2000 through 2014. This is the line for men right behind it. So actually, men and women are identically saying, yeah, I like science. There's no difference there. But now let's look at subtypes. If we say, what about technology? Do you want a career in technology? The male line is many times higher than the female line. Almost no high school girls want a career in technology. And it's been declining. Now, we can work as much as we want, but you can't force girls to play with boy toys or boys to play with girl toys. You can never, I believe, force these lines to converge. I could well be wrong about that, but so far they've been very far apart. I believe this is relevant to the current disparities. Maybe things will change in the future, but I think this is unbelievably relevant to the current disparities. For engineering, it's even more stark. So boys like physical systems. Boys tend to be higher on systemizing, lower on empathizing. There are differences. So when we look at the educational choices that boys and girls make, we see differences. Now, is that institutional sexism, or is that a free country that has removed barriers for women? Not all barriers. I understand there are indignities faced by women in their daily lives. But to say that Harvard engineering or any other branch of the university is sexist because of the disparity is a logical error. The deeper problem here is that we all know that correlation does not imply causation. We all know that if you see that autism and organic food sales have gone up, we don't say, well, clearly autism causes organic food sales to go up because autistic people buy organic food sales. Nor do we say that organic food caused autism. We say, well, that's just a correlation. Probably there's no causal relationship. When we read a study showing that people have more sex make more money, any social scientist would instantly say, interesting, perhaps there's a third variable. Yes, extroversion. People who are extroverted have more sex and they make more money. So we all know this. We all know that there are third variables. We all know that correlation does not imply causation. We all know this. But if you go to Social Justice University, you are taught, you are instructed over and over again that if group X is underrepresented, that proves, or at least strongly suggests, that there is systemic or structural discrimination against group X. That is a logical error, but that is what we teach in our social science departments and our humanities departments. This is, of course, false. Correlation does not imply causation. It does offer an invitation to look more closely. And if you want to queer in social justice, by all means, look for the disparities. And then see if you can investigate to see, is there really differential treatment? That's the key. There really could be. I'm not saying that everything is rosy and fine. I'm saying correlation does not imply causation. And if you do an experimental manipulation, which is the only way you can really know, you find, as Williams and CC did, they sent out resumes to scientists all over the country, asked them to judge, would you bring this person in for an interview? And sure enough, just by swapping the sex, it makes a big difference, 2-1. By 2-1, everybody wants the woman. By 2-1, because look, everyone's on the left, everyone's concerned about gender equality, so of course, if an application comes in from one, of course you're going to bring it for an interview. So are the universities systemically sexist or systemically anti-sexist? I mean, those of us who are inside it, well, I'm sure there's disagreement on this, but and maybe it's both. But there's an awful lot that is anti-sexist and anti-racist about our universities. So the next time you hear a social justice claim backed up by nothing but a disparity, I would like you to say, disparate outcomes do not imply disparate treatment. There could be disparate treatment, by all means look for it, but you can't infer it just from the disparity. Also, a point that I never hear anyone make, false accusations are actually a bad thing. You never hear anyone point that out. But accusing people of racism and sexism when they're innocent is actually a bad thing. And we need to tell our students this. You can't just go around accusing people falsely. But it's kind of like, you know, saying a Hail Mary. It's like there's something you do in your religion. You say it many times a day, like sexist, racist, sexist. That's just what it is to be in the religion of social justice, as you make a lot of accusations. And that's victimhood culture. So the next point, this is the one that I hope will maybe lead to the most discussion. This is the one that I think is most philosophically interesting. What is justice? What is social justice? I've done a fair amount of reading about social justice and trying to figure out what it really means. Here's the closest I can come up with. So the deep psychology of fairness for human beings is called equity theory. I mean, there's more to it, but one of the core ideas is equity theory, which is that we all keep track in any cooperative enterprise. We all keep track of what am I getting out of this and how much should I put in? And if my roommate is getting more out of it but putting less in, I'm going to get mad at him eventually. So we keep track of this. We want those things to be equal. And when our inputs are all equal, then we get a special case, which is that we expect our outcomes to be all equal. So equality is a very, very important concept, but it is a subtype or subset of proportionality. Now, if you are doing more work or putting more in than Mary, who's doing more than Bob, and all of our outcomes are equal, then you are going to feel resentment. This we generally think is not fair. So as I understand it, as I think about it, social justice is a very meaningful concept if it is a subset of justice where some people are treated differently because of their race or gender or other status. If we have disparate treatment, that is injustice. And I am opposed to it, all of us are opposed to it. We may not always see it, we need people to point it out. So when social justice is a subset of justice, it is good and right, and there actually is no incompatibility with truth. The problem is that social justice, as it is practiced in the United States today, and I think for the last couple decades, is focused on equal outcomes. And if you insist that there be equal outcomes for all groups, and you don't attend to inputs or third variables, then you are forced to commit injustice and dishonesty. Let me give you an example. In 2006, the Bush administration, Department of Education, was ramping up Title IX enforcement. That might surprise you, but look how they did it. All over the country, boys are much more likely to be expelled or suspended than girls. Are you surprised? But this could be argued to violate Title IX, because Title IX forbids discrimination by gender. And so the Department of Education told schools, you must eliminate your punishment disparities. You must equalize. And this led to a new policy all over the country. Schools had to really crack down on the girls. Girls are much better students. They're much more responsible. They're not as violent. But the schools, you know, any little thing a girl does, we got to punish, because we got to get those rates to equalize. And if the boys did something that wasn't violent, we got to let it go, because again, we got to get those rates to equalize. The feds are pressuring us. OK, now, you're probably shocked by this, as you should be, because it didn't happen. I made this up. I made up a situation in which boys' violation rates are higher than girls. We know that. There's no disputing that. Yet the outcomes were supposed to be equalized. And that obviously is unfair, right? That's incredibly unfair. That's an abomination of justice. So what actually happened was that in 2014, the Obama administration pointed out that racial disparities in suspension rates are very large. And so in the Minneapolis public schools in particular, blacks and Latinos are suspended 10 times more often than whites and Asians. Now, this could very well be disparate treatment. It could very well be the case that for the same offense, a black kid's more likely, and that would be injustice. And that, so they're not wrong to raise the issue. I think that's appropriate. But the way that they raise the issue is so heavy-handed, so threatening. What they do is they tell schools that they must eliminate or they must reduce their disparities. So a dear colleague letter, this is the way that the federal government basically threatens universities, saying, dear colleague, it's kind of like a protection racket. Dear colleague, you got a nice racket there. Wouldn't want you to lose all federal funding, would we? And so the Minneapolis public schools, under pressure, the chairwoman of the Board of Education says, okay, new policy. We're going to make it much harder to suspend black and Latino kids because we've got to get those rates down. She says, and they succeeded in reducing suspension rates by 50%. She remains committed to completely eliminating the racial suspension gap by 2018. Now, that's social justice, right? So if the black and Latino violation rate is higher than the white and Asian rate, which it almost certainly is, given everything we know about crime rates, given everything we know about out-of-wedlock birth rates, when there is not marriage in the house, boys in particular have developmental problems. So given everything we know, it's reasonable to suspect that this is true. Yet social justice demands that the outcomes be equated. So most of us would agree this is injustice. Social justice sometimes requires injustice. When social justice is the demand for equal treatment, it is right and just and good, and there's no problem. But when it demands equal outcomes without concern for inputs, it is unjust, and it leads to a train wreck of dishonesty within the universities. If it would just do that, there'd be no problem. But I don't think it's going to do that, because that would be to commit blasphemy. And that leads me to my last point. If social justice cannot return to being a subset of justice, then we must have a schism. And it's actually very exciting to me, because just in the last few months, the schism has begun. Brown and Chicago have identified a leader. They've taken leadership positions. So Christina Paxson said during all the protests last fall, we want students to enjoy unbridled academic opportunities, new ideas to explore and challenge, an equitable, intrinsic bedrock commitment to social justice. What does bedrock mean? It means that's what we are founded, and that's what we're all about. The faculty went wild. They loved it. Brown, by the way, is the most politically undiverse school in the country. 60-1 left-right ratio. 60-1. Now, that's just in 5 key departments. That was the study that Langford did that came out last week. But Brown was by far the most left-leaning university. And so the faculty say, we applaud the call of the president and provost to unite around a university agenda of social justice. Notice the wording, unite around. Yes, we can circle around social justice. She said it, finally. She's come out and said what our true telos is, social justice. And she committed $100 million to it. So Brown, that's fine. It's a free country. Let them take the leadership position. Chicago was staked at the opposite side. The dean of students sent out a letter. It was rather clumsy. I think he made a big mistake in saying, we do not condone the creation of intellectual safe spaces. That's a foolish thing to say because there's a constitutional right to free association. If students want to create a safe space in a dorm room or whatever, of course they can. And I think he meant that. But I think what he meant to say is that the classroom, official University of Chicago functions are not safe spaces. I think that's what he meant to say. And that's a reasonable position also. And so Chicago has staked out leadership position there. Now, I want to point out that we've actually already had the schism because even though these schools, these old schools, said veritas, they were actually religious schools, and they thought that biblical revelation was compatible with truth. Over time, it became increasingly clear that it was not. And as that happened, we had a schism in which some schools committed to the Bible. So here's Wheaton College, and they say right there on their webpage, for Christ and his kingdom, if you go to Wheaton, you're there to serve Christ in his kingdom. They say it again in the mission statement. Wheaton College serves Jesus Christ and advances his kingdom through excellence in liberal arts. So yeah, you'll take English classes, you'll take history classes, but our telos is not truth. We're all clear about that, right? Okay, just so we're clear, your telos is not truth, your telos is Christ. Free country, choose to come or not, we're clear about what we stand for. And so all I'm saying is that since we've already had a schism in which some schools went for Christ and some went for truth, I think the last 5 years has forced us to a second schism. We simply have to decide. Some schools can stand for social justice, so students who are committed to being on the left and who don't want to be exposed to other ideas, they can go to Brown. Students who want to devote themselves to Christ, they can go to Wheaton. And students who want to devote themselves to truth can go to Chicago. This is what I think we need to do. I don't think that Chicago and Brown can coexist in the same academic community. So which way will Harvard go? That's the question. And that's my talk. I just want to end by pointing to these two very, very different and I believe fundamentally incompatible views of a university. You might believe that the point of a university is to change the world, or you might believe that the point of the university is to understand the world. I, for one, don't want anybody setting out to try to change complex institutions when their education has systematically disabled them from understanding those institutions. Thank you. Questions?
Yeah.
So how long was that?
Do you want me to
manage? Yeah, why don't you call?
All right. Reggie, let's hear.
It's all I can do to keep myself from cheering your talk. And of course, one thinks of the noble efforts of Harvey and other people for the last quarter century against political correctness. But I have a very simple question. Just as your article in The Atlantic in 2015, in that year, was the best reading I did on freedom of speech, in 2016 it is the stunning new book by Timothy Garton Ash on free speech. I'd be interested in your comments about the book and how it relates to your...
I heard references to it, I don't know his argument. I haven't read it.
Okay. You will.
You want to give us one key insight from it?
I've only read 100 out of 400 pages, and of course I copied down he distills everything into 10 basic principles, but he runs a website based, is he at Oxford or Cambridge? I've forgotten. And he blogs, he deals he's involved in free speech issues apparently all over the world. He, just as you seem to be involved in university free speech issues throughout the United States, he's probably your worldwide equivalent.
Yeah, it turns out, so when I wrote the Coddling article with Lukianoff, we thought it was just the USA, but just in the last year it's really spread very quickly to Britain, and there are hints of it in Australia. Not so much New Zealand, and a little in Canada. So it's an Anglosphere thing. It's not really on the continent of Europe yet, but it's an Anglosphere thing.
Catherine.
I have two quick questions.
Please.
So I like that this, I can imagine that why the transition from the honor society to dignity society, because honor society, has like self-help thingy, and that's not sustainable.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But what do you think that the motive, the reason or cause, a transition from this dignity to victimhood society? That's the first question. Second question, I found it interesting, you sort of pointed out the similarity between honor and this victimhood culture, because both cultures are very sensitive to insult.
Okay.
But I found that a big difference is in the case of a victimhood culture, who should feel sensitive is already decided.
Mm-hmm.
If you're a straight, white, male, Christian, you're not sensitive. You're not supposed to be sensitive.
Yeah.
But if you're weak, a woman, and this one, yes, I feel great. So there is a big difference here. I think if we focus on sensitivity, I'm afraid we are losing the big picture.
Mm-hmm.
Something decides who should feel more sensitive, who should not feel sensitive.
Okay.
So those are two questions.
So on the question of what caused the transition,
yes.
I think there are several intersecting strands that things that have come together. I'll just pick three of them.
Mm-hmm.
The biggest one, I believe, is the disappearance of unsupervised time from American childhood in the 80s and 90s. So until the early 1980s, all American kids, by the time they were 7 or 8, had unsupervised time.
Mm-hmm.
I would go over to my friend's house. I'd walk there. And when I was in second or third grade, my friend and I would ride our bicycle around town. We'd build forts. We'd steal things. We'd set them on fire. So that's what,
That's the problem.
But the point is, but sometimes we'd get in fights with other kids, and we had to deal with it. And sometimes kids would call me names, and I had to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm Jewish, and sometimes kids would. I mean, there was. You know, I grew up in Scarsdale. It was a very Jewish town. But the point is, it wouldn't occur to me if somebody called me an anti-Semitic. It wouldn't occur to me to go to an adult.
Mm-hmm.
And so, kids used to get, let's say, 10,000 cases of insults or exclusion or marginalization, you might say, and they learned to deal with it. This is the way the immune system is. So. Beginning in 1979 with the abduction and murder of Eitan Peitz, 6-year-old boy in New York City, and then Adam Walsh in 1981, another 6-year-old boy, and then we get cable TV. And there really was a crime wave in the 70s and 80s. It was a big crime wave. And so American parents stopped letting their kids out because Adam Walsh's father starts the Center for Missing and Exploited Children. He's the one who puts the kids' photos on milk cartons. So now all across America, beginning in 1984, we think there's an epidemic of child abduction. There never was. But we really start, parents start freaking out. And by the time you get to the 90s, you get the zero tolerance policies on bullying. So if any kid does anything or even says an insult to another kid, you have to go to the adult. You can't settle it yourself. So we've systematically deprived kids of the experience of facing down a threat or an insult or an exclusion by themselves. And so you can call it helicopter parenting. So since in the last 10 or 15 years, 10 years or so, all of the students who are on college, who are Americans, this is foreign students, this is not true. I think they're a lot tougher. But the American-raised kids have been so weakened that words really do hurt them. Words really do feel like violence. And they're so morally dependent. There has always been an adult responsible, always. And they want that in college, too. So I think that's the major cause. There are other strands. One is social media. Young people today are immersed in a technology that allows everybody to create a flash mob against anyone in a moment. We were not raised that way, but young people were. So they're much more fearful of inciting offense in others. And there are a couple of others. What are the other big ones for causality? Also rising political polarization, because this is very much tied up with social justice morality is very much a left-wing political movement. And so as the hatred between left and right has gone up and up and up, it imports itself into the fragility and the safety culture, so that conservative ideas in general are violence, and they have to be kept out. And then the last one, let's see, but there was one. Oh, yeah, and then you have the ideas of Foucault and others. You have these intellectual traditions of dividing people into the power, the privileged, and the victims. And so it all comes together in the last few years. I'll just stop with that.
Thank
you. Yes.
Hi. Well, thanks so much for coming here. I'm Peter. I self-identify as Asian American, a physicist, and right of center, which means I am unique here. That's why I also don't worry about online serving because I'm easy to find, right?
Okay.
But I wanted to amplify your argument a little bit because you didn't talk about Asians, and if you're a cis hetero single Asian male, you're everything in terms of, on outcomes we slightly outperform white men, but you still suffer, of course, some of the problems of being a racial minority. So if you're talking about that sort of input-output ratio, I think you didn't talk about Asian males, but we're systematically discriminated against when it comes to things like affirmative action, and yet...
You can't talk about that.
That's true.
Yeah, well,
bless me.
But I would also say that to your point on the other side, and so speaking now from the sciences, that basically we are told so much that, you know, inclusivity, encouragement, there's no actual basis that encouragement of anybody makes them better scientists or engineers. Just because you feel better about yourself doesn't mean you actually work better.
That's right.
But I think that exactly to your point, the type of feedback that we give to people who are part of these underrepresented, your sort of six groups plus of the discriminated, they don't get the same kind of training. Because if there's a white guy up there giving a talk, we will tear into him, we will rip him to shreds,
exactly.
And it's like it's training, it's like boxing or whatever.
And we take it easy on others.
Yeah, and then you go out into the international job market and you get smoked if you have no idea what you're doing,
right?
And I think what saves us actually in the sciences is the fact that the proportion of Americans is smaller and smaller, right? So more than half of our, say, postdoctoral researchers or grad students, roughly speaking, in physics and engineering are foreign. And the ones from China, I can certainly speak knowing this, right? The Cultural Revolution was all about having your family denounced and deported for thought crimes against the government, which is, please tell me how that's any different than how things are going today.
No, it is,
but if you want people who are intolerant of political correctness, talk to the half of the department that comes from China.
No, that's right. Those are great points. So just very briefly, I don't talk about Asians because the social justice folks don't talk about Asians, because Asians tie their head in knots. Because if America is so systemically racist and the language of majority-minority, when I was growing up, everybody was either black or white, practically. And so the language of majority-minority, and of course the majority is exclusionary, et cetera. And Asian success, Asian spectacular success, puts the lie to that. And that's very uncomfortable. So that's why Asians don't really play a role here. The social justice folks just want to cover it up. Obviously, there is real discrimination against Asians in admissions. And again, they don't want to talk about that. Affirmative action is a sacred topic. We can't have an open discussion about affirmative action. So that's that point. And on the point about preparing for the international job market, yes, I hear more and more. I mean, you hear all these statistics. You know, the heads of all the biggest companies, a large number of the biggest and most successful tech companies were not raised in the United States. Because if you're raised in the United States, you turn into a weakling. You can't handle anything. So I think it's a matter of national survival and security and economic prosperity. We've got to stop this safety culture, which is crippling our kids.
Thank you.
Yes.
My question is about your very interesting thought experiment of having this bifurcated university system. And I wonder if the people you're arguing against would accept the very terms on which you argue in the following sense. Well, let's take the word diversity, which seems to be, I think, one of the most kind of core principles that university bureaucrats have, but also I think a lot of advocates of justice, whether social or individual. You know, the idea of diversity in 1978 came up in the Supreme Court case Bakke versus Regents, and there Justice Powell, kind of on a one-off, because right, it was a 4-1-4 decision, Justice Powell said, you cannot do racial quotas, but if it serves the educational function of the university, meaning the search for truth, then you can have diversity.
Right.
And this doctrine really became kind of imbibed in the institutional culture of university bureaucracies. And I think that what many administrators and advocates of social justice believe today with regard to the word diversity is that you cannot have a search for truth unless you have an adequate representation of different points of view.
I agree.
Which are not purely intellectual ones, and this is where the other two terms come in, and I'd like to hear your analysis of these terms. One is identity, and the other is inclusivity, right? Because the idea of diversity is that you need to be able to have a representation of certain perspectives, but that you can only get those authentic perspectives from certain individuals who belong to certain social groups.
That's exactly what John Stuart Mill said.
Right.
The phrase after the one I showed was, it is not enough to hear these opposing views from professors or from people who don't believe them themselves. It is only if you hear them authentically from people who hold those views that you can actually learn from them. So I fully agree with everything you said. I also agree with George Will, who wrote a few years ago, that there's a certain kind of liberal who wants diversity in everything except thought. And this is what we have. Once we have made diversity a religious mantra, but we don't really mean diversity. It's a code word for racial diversity primarily, and also gender and other kinds of diversity. The psychology research is pretty clear that when diversity has benefits, and those benefits are much smaller than you might think, it's actually very hard to show that diversity makes groups function better. There are some studies that show it, but most, it's a small effect and it's unstable. But to the extent that diversity actually does help creativity, it's diversity of viewpoints. That's what helps. And so, yes, you need diversity of viewpoints, I believe, in the academy especially. Now, to the extent that gender is relevant, I fully agree. When psychology was almost all male and you had men talking about female development, it was a joke. And Carol Gilligan talks about this, what it was like to be a woman in psychology in the 60s. And she pushed and others pushed to get women admitted, and our field got better. And so, yes, an all-male psychology can't handle the full range of psychology. We needed women. And the same thing for race. You need black psychologists. So I'm fully on board with the idea that to find truth, we need a diversity. But where are we now? We've done an awful lot to promote gender and race diversity. In my field, LGBT is actually overrepresented. About 5 or 6% of the field is gay. So we've done a lot to increase this diversity. And as these ethnic diversities and identity diversity has gone up, the political diversity has plummeted. And I would argue that to do good work, if you had to pick one of those, I think by far the most important is the viewpoint diversity, the political. That's the most important. They're all important. But viewpoint diversity is the most important, and it's the only one that's been going down, and it's the only one which is now gone. So I would say if you have $100 to spend on diversity, you should spend all 100 of it on political and viewpoint diversity.
Here's a question about psychology. To what extent is your argument not only against most psychologists, but also against psychology itself as a field? I notice that when you want to state your fundamental principles, you don't go to psychologists but to philosophers. Maybe that's for rhetoric. But isn't psychology devoted to therapy?
No.
Speaking generally,
no.
As opposed to what we were talking about earlier, hard knocks, and being able to suffer bad experiences.
Well, Harvey, you're a professor of government. Are you devoted to governing?
Yeah, in a way.
I think psychology, yes, I get asked that question a lot, whether I take patients, and I say no, I couldn't stand to listen to people tell me their problems for hours a day. So it's true that, it's true that a branch of psychology is applied. Was a psychologist, Hume was a psychologist. So if you look at it in that tradition, it's a science, it's a social science. No, I love my field. And I also must say that since I started raising the alarm about this in 2011, nothing bad has happened to me. Now, if I had done this in anthropology, it would have been much harder. But in psychology, in social psychology especially, the response has generally been, you might be right about that. That makes sense. I don't know what we're going to do about it. I don't know where we're going to find conservatives, but you may be right. So I think my field is actually not crazy. It just has, for a variety of reasons, become unbalanced, and it's damaging the research.
But still, wouldn't you say that on the whole it's devoted to therapy?
No.
No?
Maybe you were—you learned about psychology back in the Freudian era or something, but no.
Well, I notice you haven't mentioned Freud or...
Right, because I'm talking about psychology.
But don't all these counselors, that make things easier for students, don't they all have degrees not in political philosophy but in psychology?
Well, yeah. In clinical psychology training programs, does Freud play much of a role? None. Yeah.
Well, never mind about Freud.
Yeah, no, in English departments. Yeah, in English departments.
Yeah, I did. Okay.
Enjoyed the talk very much. I wonder if you're possibly more sanguine than I am about the possibility of this bifurcation of the universities. I got my PhD at Chicago, and things at the moment, look possibly pretty good there. My son's a high school junior, and I mentioned to him that I think that might be a more suitable place for him than Harvard, where I was undergrad. Sorry, Harvey. But still, the faculty has not been supportive since that statement. The student body, from what I hear, the student government took a vote not to support that policy.
The student government took a vote and that vote passed to reject the statement?
No, it wasn't a rejection. It was somebody proposed a statement supporting the after the report came out, before this letter, after the report that preceded the letter, the student government.
Oh, the Chicago principles, which came out 2 years ago?
Yes.
Oh, the students rejected it?
There was a discussion among the student body. One student said, let's take a vote in favor of these principles, mm-hmm. and they decided against.
Oh, right. They decided not to even
they
vote.
They decided not to do
that's
that.
Right.
Yeah.
That's right.
They did not vote against.
Yeah.
So that was good. I mean, I think there are differences among the universities. I wonder, though, if those differences are strong enough to sustain a genuine continuing stand for Veritas and against social justice.
Yes.
Is what we're seeing part of a general movement? I mean, I should say there are smaller schools, I think, which are somewhat more, you know, maybe St. John's, where there's a stronger dedication to that tradition. But among the really major universities, is there anywhere that's really going to resist, you know, stand in the way of this train? Or is
yes.
it just part of the unfolding of democracy, of ever greater attachment to equality, and, you know, general movements in our time?
Great question. So I started a group called Heterodox Academy after my colleagues and I wrote a paper on the loss of viewpoint diversity. And we learned that it's the same problem in law and sociology and other fields. We bought the website domain Heterodox Academy, put up a site in September of 2015. And then all hell broke loose in November and December. And there was a stampede towards safety culture all over the country. And it seemed to, so we created this site, Heterodox Academy. All of you who are faculty members, I invite you to join. Just go there, you can sign up. And we're not just blogging and writing and trying to do the professor thing about making arguments. We actually have a plan for our small organization to help create this split. And the idea is this. There's a gigantic market failure going on now, which is that most parents don't want to send their kids to a place like Brown or Missouri or Yale. Obviously, they want Yale the prestige, but they prefer not to have a climate where everyone's on eggshells. But at present, there's no university to serve them. Now, there are some that are better and worse, but nobody knows where to go. Secondly, the alumni are almost uniformly furious. The alumni generally, whether they're on the left or the right, if they're on the left, they're liberal left, not illiberal left. So the alumni are furious, but they haven't stopped giving. The big donors have not stopped giving. And so our goal is to give them a clear stop and go signal. And so that's what we're launching on Monday. We're going to launch the Heterodox Academy Guide to Colleges. So you've heard of the US News and World Report Guide? You know, you want to go to a place with a certain faculty-student ratio? You can integrate all these numbers? Well, that's great. What if you actually care about viewpoint diversity? What if you actually want your kid exposed to a variety of ideas? Where would you go? Nobody knows. Come to Heterodox Academy, we'll tell you. So we've codified, so far we have four pieces of information, whether or not they endorse the Chicago principles, what their rating is from FIRE, the Foundation for Individual Rights and Education, what's the rating from ISI, which is a conservative group. So if ISI says this is a bad place for conservatives, don't go there, that should be relevant even if you're on the left. You shouldn't want to go to a school that suppresses conservatives. And lastly, incidents that indicate, not just one crazy thing, but that indicate sort of broad campus sentiment or policy. And here's the way the numbers look. So these are the best. There's only a few schools that on net are green or above zero. So the best one is Chicago. And so Chicago so far has gotten, it's not perfect, you're right. And as we get more refined, we'll find ways of judging student sentiment. But so far, Chicago gets a 4.0, Purdue gets 3.0, and then you have a few schools, Tennessee, Maryland, you get a few schools that are at one. And now let's look at the bottom of the list. So we have 150. So far, we take the 150 top schools in the US News World Report. We've done this for all 150. Here's the bottom. The worst school in the country so far, and okay, this list is not so accurate that I can say that half point means anything, but the bottom, at the very bottom is, let's see.
Is Harvard anywhere on this?
Yes, hold on, let me show you. So at the very bottom, the worst is, goes Missouri, then and Eugene, Oregon, then Brown, Northwestern, and then after Northwestern comes Rutgers and Harvard. So Harvard is the seventh worst school in the country. Now again, I can't really say seventh versus 15th, but it's certainly in the top half.
Why not Yale, though?
Yale's bad, too. Yeah, Yale's in there, too. I can go over. No, basically, all the Ivies are terrible except for Princeton. Princeton is the only one that's green, that's above zero. Princeton seems to be the best.
Because of Robbie George.
Well, no, it's not. It's also part of their brand. No, so it's true. There are two schools that have a known conservative at them, and Princeton is the other one. So anyway, so in answer to your question, what I've seen is that America is now in a giant case of the emperor's new clothes. So the social justice activists are extremely vociferous. Everyone's afraid to stand up to them, but there's not that many of them. And as I've stood up, and as others have stood up, nothing bad happens to us. And a lot of people covertly say thank you. So it's the emperor's new clothes. And if we can simply create enough market differentiation and identify, and then we're gonna, I'm speaking at the American Council of Trustees and Alumni, and we're going to try to get tell them a very clear say, look at our list, and if your school is red, stop giving, and tell the president, I'll give when you approve. So I think we can actually put a lot of pressure on the presidents, because at present all the pressure comes from the social justice activists, the diversity industrial complex, and the federal government. And we can bring pressure from alumni, donors, and applying students. My guess is Chicago's applications are the pool is going to surge. Brown's and Missouri's are going to plummet. So we'll see. Oh, Harvey?
Yeah, Alex.
It occurs to me, though, that one risk of doing this might be to further marginalize the humanities, because the public...
Yes, exactly. That is definitely likely to happen.
The humanities are bullshit, pardon me. And, science is solid, and presumably there's less of this in science.
No, that's correct. I think that would have to happen. And the reason is this, that the humanities are essential for understanding humanity. The humanities, most of us loved reading when we were younger. My wife went to Smith, an English major. She loved literature, so she got a master's degree at UVA. That's where we met. And she, like most people, hated it because she loved literature. And if you get a master's degree in English, it has nothing to do with enjoying reading. It's all about basically political stuff. And so to the extent I believe that at a social justice university where all departments are focused on racial justice, the humanities will thrive. But at a truth-based university, we should still have scholars who are studying texts, who are studying the history of literature. We'll still have a philosophy department. That should be okay. Gender studies and race studies, those, I don't know if you could have departments that weren't primarily activist. So my preference would be that the coursework is very important. The coursework would, so you'd have history of women, you'd have all the history courses and sociology courses, but I don't think you could have a department. So yes, it would look very different, and it would not be a complete duplicate. Probably there would be no sciences at the social justice universities.
Anna.
Yes, thank you for your time. It was very enjoyable and refreshing from here. How, in your research, I haven't read much of it, but it seems there are two strands and two lines along which you think, and one is the liberal conservative divide, and one has to be the true false divide. And how do they map onto one another? I'm German, and our universities, as you said, are not quite as politicized yet. And when I came here 7 years ago, it was striking to me that the first thing you would learn about somebody is whether they're conservative or liberal. It's really insane.
Yeah.
And because those viewpoints, as you say, that cause diversity, they should have nothing or very little to do with what you find in your whatever, when you do empirical social sciences, or when you find things that are simply false. You pointed out so many things where you said false, false, false. Mm-hmm. Why not speak more about that and not say, the conservatives now are more aligned with the truth? Yeah. Doesn't it require one in principle?
So I usually try to... I'm very influenced by the economist Dan Klein, who's trying to reclaim the word liberal for libertarians, because liberal should have something to do with liberty or freedom. And in America, we ruined the word by basically just saying liberal is left, and it's not. It really confuses us. I think a more helpful concept is illiberal. So you can be illiberal, which means I'm going to tell you what you can say, what you can do. I'm going to put restraints on you. That's illiberal. And you can be on the left and be illiberal, which is what the social justice activists are, or you can be on the left and be liberal, which is what most of the faculty are. So it's a war between illiberalism and liberalism, but it gets very confused because of our terminology. Similarly on the right, many of the center-right people who believe in free markets and small governments are extremely liberal in the sense of believing in freedom and the various institutions that create a free society. And as we've seen with the alt-right and other movements and the authoritarian appeal of Donald Trump, there is a lot on the right that's illiberal. So America is now being convulsed in a way which I find really scary, which is that this country, which along with the UK has been basically the leading countries of the liberal tradition, America is being rocked by illiberalism on the left and which is more resilient against this sort of stuff. So in Germany, you don't have the fragility that we have. But from what I hear, German social scientists are all on the left and very much concerned with social justice too, aren't they?
I've been out of the system for a while now, but that's true. And there are incidents that you read about professors who are I don't know, Helfried Munkler, a famous political scientist, he's being heckled in classes, there are petitions being written against him in Berlin, for instance. So you have these things, yeah. Very much the policing is beginning.
Yeah.
But I think so far, it's not that you could say, you know, it's the conservatives that somehow suddenly are on the side of the truth, and the social democrats are all completely...
Yeah. I don't say that the conservatives are on the side of truth here. I say that the conservatives are necessary for us to find the truth. And since we have systematically excluded them and overtly and consciously discriminate against them. And you ask, you know, there's a survey asking people in social psychology, if you found out that somebody was conservative, how would that affect your likelihood of hiring them into your department or giving them a grant or anything else? And only 20% said not at all. 80% said to some degree they'd be less likely. So we're very overt in our willingness to discriminate against conservatives, and what I'm saying is that's what prevents us from finding the truth.
That is terrible, but why not speak more directly about things that are true and false, as you did in your talk, very much so, and separate
yeah.
to some
well,
extent.
It's because I think I disagree with you when you said that as social scientists, we should just see what is, and it shouldn't matter whether on the left or the right. I certainly believe that there is truth, but I believe that our motivated cognition runs so deep that if you're on the left or the right, you're going to see what you want to see. And I see humans as so flawed, so biased, so unfixable, that we need institutions, and that's the genius of the liberal tradition, is creating institutions like democratic government, universities, and juries that basically cancel out the flaws. So I think we can't fix the individuals. We're made from crooked timber. But if you put us together in the right way, we can still get truth nonetheless.
But you fixed yourself about 5 years ago.
But but as they say, you know, what's the joke? How many psychologists does it take to change a light bulb? You know that one? You know, one, but it's a long process, and the light bulb has to really want to change. And it took me...
So Harvey's right after all.
So it took me about 8 years of study, and the only reason I started it is because I hated the Republicans so much that I wanted to help the Democrats beat the Republicans. That's why I started studying political psychology. And it's only because I started reading conservatives in order to help the Democrats. That's the only reason I started. And over many years, I started learning a lot and saying, oh, wow, I never thought of that. Or, oh, my God, that's a great idea. But it took many years. And so I can't say, now, if only everybody would write a book on political psychology and spend 8 years reading conservatives, then they would be honest. I can't recommend that.
Thank you for your talk. My name is Rekha. One thing I wondered about when you showed there are fewer and fewer conservatives on university faculties, mm-hmm. is that partly because there are more conservatives in think tanks?
Yes.
And also
That's
the
correct.
Churches now have policy arms,
yes.
think tanks. And how much is that offset?
Yes, so this is a real problem. That as polarization has increased, as the hatred of the other side, which is symmetrical, it's not that, so it's very symmetrical, as this has happened, Americans have purified themselves and their institutions. So as I understand it, many Christian denominations are purifying over gay marriage and ordination of women. And so I'm not sure exactly what's happening with the Episcopalians, but when the Catholic Church, they have to stay together, they can't split. But Protestant denominations are splitting, and university departments are splitting. And so there are some conservatives who get PhDs, but they're not going to get a job at a university. So they work for think tanks, where sometimes they're a little different. But so this is a huge problem. And so if we actually want to solve problems, I think we need collaborations between universities and think tanks. I ended up running one last year. I organized a dinner between experts on the left and the right to try to figure out what's going on with inequality. And we couldn't reach agreement, but what we discovered is that we all were really bothered by poverty, and especially child poverty, and the transmission across generations. Whether you're on the left or the right, that's an abomination. And so we created a working group. We had 7 scholars on the left who were all at universities, and 7 on the right, 6 of whom were at universities. One was Larry Mead, who's the third conservative in the academy. And it was wonderful because it took a year, but once we developed personal relationships and we began to trust each other, we actually really listened to each other. So so I think it's very hard to find that diversity anymore, but yes, we have to be bringing in the think tanks, so that's where the conservative intellectuals increasingly are. Would you agree with that, Harvey, or am I missing something?
No, I do agree, yes. Okay. Yes, and Manny.
I'm a bit of a pessimist myself also, and I was wondering if you thought, looking at all these different societies and political systems, whether you whether you think an adjustment in the politics would be necessary to have a more favorable outcome in this battle between social justice versus truth, let's say. That whether the current system might not be too secular, too democratic, you know, compared to previous systems where we had healthier, more robust debate, more diversity in viewpoints, and a healthier life in the universities, or whether you think it's possible to keep the current political system with the level of equality,
political system, do you mean like the American political system of electing congressmen and presidents?
I mean the more extreme character of it that we've seen since, let's say, the 60s. But, you know, perhaps, you know, you could say that one thing inevitably leads to another, so that, you know, once you set up a system as we did in the, you know, the 1700s.
Systems can run off the rails.
And the stronger part gets stronger and stronger and more and more extreme, so that, you know, eventually you get to this. Mm-hmm. But
I think it's helpful to think about, just as it's helpful to think about diversity and what is really true and right and good about diversity, it's helpful to think about affirmative action. So affirmative action, as I understand it, originally meant that if you just let things go, we're not going to achieve racial equality. And so companies and the military have to take affirmative steps. Now, whether one of those steps should be giving preferences based on category membership, that's very controversial. But if we mean that an institution has a problem, be it an efficiency problem or a justice problem, if an institution has a problem, it is obligated then to take affirmative steps to fix that problem. I'm a very strong believer in affirmative action in that sense, both for race and for political diversity. On diversity, on racial preferences in college admissions, it's an empirical question whether it does more harm than good. I believe that it does more harm than good for the black students themselves. I'm not confident in that. The data is not very good. But from what I've been able to assemble, and I have an article in the Wall Street Journal with Lee Justin on this, we think it does more harm than good. Political diversity in the university, I believe, would do more good than harm. And so I actually might favor, I think I favor, if a university is trying to consider two candidates to hire on the faculty or grad students to admit, and they're similarly qualified, but one brings more viewpoint diversity, this is exactly the situation that the Supreme Court said you can discriminate on. You can actually give a preference. So whether that be for race, gender, or viewpoint diversity, I think we desperately need viewpoint diversity. And I think universities have a moral obligation and a professional obligation to make this one of their top priorities. And I'm hopeful that a few will. I know most won't, but if a few do, then over time, good scholars will gravitate to those universities because that's the place where scholarship actually continues.
Sure.
I'll try to add to diversity by being slightly more optimistic. And while I agree with so much of what you said, one thing that doesn't quite resonate is your description of students, because it doesn't look like my students. When I have teach a course called Rights in Conflict, and we talk about affirmative action and gay marriage and sexual harassment rules, and I don't find the students either walking on eggshells or being particularly intolerant. Now, I assume that that has something to do with, in some ways, a safe space where we're expected to argue about these things. I don't know if it's because maybe political science students are more open to debate, because I think that's what politics is about. I don't think it's because Boston College, particularly. I just wonder, could it be that in political science departments, having read John Shields and Josh Dunn, plus it's slightly more diverse than some other social sciences. But I'm just trying to square what I see in the classroom with the descriptions of students that you give, and I'm not sure why I find it different.
Okay. Well, so remember that this all spread just 11 months ago. This whole thing is only 11 months old. So it's been incubating since the 90s in some places. But most of us, even 1 year ago, had not heard the word microaggression. So the Coddling article came out 13 months ago, and so that brought the words to a lot of people's attention. But at most universities, there wasn't, like, if you go back 2 or 3 years, people weren't talking about microaggressions in safe spaces. But after last November and December, as far as I know, so at Boston College, I'm sure they used the word microaggression, right? Okay, 2 years ago, did they? Did you hear it 2 years ago?
That's a good point, probably not.
So this is all, so no, you don't know. So I hear this a lot from professors who say, I teach a provocative lecture on this and that, and I've had no problem. I say, all right, do it for 5 more years and then tell me. tell me how many times you've been reported to the dean. So, you know, most times you can say it and you'll be fine, but one out of three, one out of seven, I don't know what the number is, but you're basically playing Russian roulette.
Just to follow up on that, I mean, clearly there is a danger of being reported to the dean. I mean, no, if we have tenure, we can say, who cares? But
no, because it takes a lot of time. There's a lot of meetings, yeah. There are protests, yeah. It takes a lot of time.
But that does say that there, maybe one or two students would be engaged in this.
Yes,
but my point. And obviously that's a very serious
problem. You have to teach to the most sensitive student.
No, I totally agree with you. Last year, this Yale fiasco about the heroin thingy, it's just like some technology when it's got developed at a certain point, the clip.
Exactly.
I think that's what's happening since last fall.
Social media is the reason why it spreads so quickly. So the technology example is a great one.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
But you've already put your finger on something that's important, which is we can't teach most sensitive student. We have to be willing to stand up and say, no, they've reported to a dean, it's going to take some time, but we'll have allies. And I've been surprised.
You will not have allies. No one will stand up for you.
No.
I'm telling you. Oh, really?
I think it depends on the institution. Maybe we're protected at Boston College, but Chip has been a big champion pushing back, and so far it's worked.
Yeah, so the experience of the Christakises are very bitter, because if you watch those tapes, and did you see? New tapes were released last month that show about half an hour of the confrontation between Nick Christakis and the group of students, they're very bitter because very few people stood up for them, and this is what generally happens because the faculty. You're so afraid of being accused of being sexist or racist that if you side with the professor, now people turn on you, because that's what social media is all about. If someone says something and you criticize them, and then you see who's going to like my post or who's going to, I'm just warning you. I urge you to continue to stand up, but don't be so sanguine that you think that it's not there.
Catherine. Thank you.
I like your work very much, and I like your idea of the university as devoted to truth, or at least some universities. But I just wondered if you could say more about how you understand the concern with truth, the desire for truth, whether that's you hold it up as a kind of a telos that we should circle around as a sacred end, and do you think that that's something a concern inherent in human nature, or something that develops with a certain kind of upbringing or a certain culture, or does it require a belief that the truth will then be useful for further ends, especially given the motivated cognition that you.
Right. That's a good question. I mean, given that, what did the Greeks say? It was truth and beauty were two of the, what were those ends? What were truth and beauty in classical times? Harvey? I mean, these are ends that
related,
have been.
Related.
Okay. And now, I think it's important to note that everybody thinks that they and their group are pursuing truth. And so you have a lot of secular evolution types who, they have the fish, and they have the fish growing legs, and that's their poke at the Christians. But then you see Christians who have on the back of their car the Darwin fish with legs, and then it has truth eating that, and the truth has a cross on it because Christ is truth. And so everybody thinks that they have truth. And the divinity schools in the 18th century put truth on their logo. So everybody thinks they're pursuing truth. And it goes back to classical times. Now, then there's a psychological or personality element, which is that some people just really love discovery. Joseph Campbell, the mythologist, used to say, figure out what mythological character you are. And as soon as he said that, I knew I'm the explorer. I just want to learn everything, go everywhere, see everything. That just was, I have no interest in power. I don't want power. And so some people just gravitate, the act of discovery is so thrilling. And those people tend to gravitate to a university. But increasingly, the people who gravitate into academic life are those who want change in social justice. And so it's a culture clash, it's a personality clash, it's a values clash. And frankly, I I want to be around fellow people. Like, I love meeting, you know, all over the world. You can meet professors, and you have a sense that you're members of the same guild. Even if you're in a different field, you can talk to each other. You have a shared idea that there is truth out there, and it's hidden, but if we use certain methods, we can find it, and we can explain it to each other. So, I don't know, that's not exactly an answer to your question, but that's the way I think about it.
That's nice. One more.
Okay, sorry. I'm just following up on Catherine's question. So, I mean, I'm extremely sympathetic to many of your practical concerns and suggestions, but I'm a little bit hesitant to wholeheartedly endorse both the idea that I mean, there's something about bringing in quote unquote conservatives as if there are only two kinds of intellectual biases, you know, left and right, and if that meant some sort of concrete identifiable thing always. But I guess the whole idea of a dichotomy between justice and truth, I mean, isn't there a real, and that's why there's something
justice and truth are never incompatible.
Well, no, but I mean, what is justice? Your whole set of assumptions is if that's unproblematic. Mm-hmm. And some people want justice and other people want truth, but justice? I mean,
yeah.
In other words,
no,
presumably,
social justice, yeah. Yeah.
Presumably part of what a university needs to do is ask what justice is.
Mm-hmm.
At least
oh, yeah.
I feel.
It has
so
been for thousands of years. Yeah.
So that means that those two things can't be.
No. Yeah. No. Truth and justice. Yeah. Truth and justice are perfectly compatible. If justice is treat like cases alike and different cases differently is one definition. We can have lots of definitions of justice. It's going to have something to do with proportionality, what you're owed based on what you've done or not who you are. So we can have, and there have been conversations about justice for thousands of years. There's no conflict between truth and justice.
But is there a right answer to the question? What is justice?
Well. There's not one single right answer for all time, but there are cases So I'd be happy to talk about that. My view is that moral truths are emergent truths. They're like the truths of the market. And so it is true that gold is more valuable than silver. That's not just my opinion. It's not just because I like gold. Gold really is more valuable than silver. That's an emergent fact as many participate in the market.
So is that going to be an ideological touchstone of your truth university that you have to buy that position justice?
Oh no, but that's a great topic for conversation. That conversation will last at least 2,500 years.
But
so that's fine.
You know what the answer's going to be.
No, I don't. I have my.
The
I just told.
Going to be it's going to be emergent and it won't be permanent.
That's my guess as to it. But I don't want to discuss what justice is. What I want to do is say that there is no inherent conflict between a university whose telos is truth. Well, let's see. I guess I would say, if your telos is truth, and people value justice, there will be no problem. I don't think the telos could be justice. In a law school, maybe you might say that, but
if the telos is justice and you're genuinely concerned about justice, you have to be concerned about what it really is.
You have to be concerned about what is really true.
If it's not concerned with justice, but some kind of ideological commitment that you call justice, then sure, they're separable.
Exactly. That's my whole point right there.
But if you're genuinely concerned with justice, maybe you have to wonder what it is.
Yeah.
And that's part of...
No, right. We're not disagreeing. Because you keep saying justice, so we don't disagree. If you say social justice, then we can disagree.
Time always runs out on philosophy. So, thank you.